A study came out that examined the emotions and attributes that make people feel self-conscious about their appearance. And the study revealed that 59% of us are not comfortable in our own skin, meaning when we look in the mirror, we go, oh, who's this crazy looking person I'm looking at? Sometimes social media plays a big role in that, putting on clothes that are a little bit tighter, even things like skin problem. All of those things lead to maybe a little bit of lack of confidence. Add into that aging and just changing as the tide goes. There's a lot of decisions that need to be made for any individual when it comes to their look. Case in point, you take someone like Sharon Osbourne, who's been on TV for years. She's now on The Talk. Before that, she was a judge on America's Got Talent, and she's been Ozzy Osbourne's manager for years. She's had a lot of plastic surgery, but recently she decided to go back to her natural hair color. For years, when you've seen her in magazines and on TV, she's had that dark red hair. Now she's 100% white, which is her natural hair color. That's a decision she needed to make and wanted to make, just about changing her life up and going back to her original hair color and being proud of it and not being worried about the hubbubaloo of keeping up with Instagram pictures and magazine covers. I think a lot of people, when they look in the mirror, they think about these changes that they could make. And some people go and get help, and other people get on treadmills. And there's a lot of decisions that are made. Joining us now is Dr. Stephen Mulholland. He is the founder of Spa Medica and one of Canada's top cosmetic surgeon. Dr. Stephen, welcome to the Nightside.
Well, thank you for having me.
Now, I know Sharon Osbourne, she's had four different facelifts. So this is a woman that is not afraid to change her looks, not afraid to update her look. Obviously, the drastic hair color is the most recent one. But when someone goes in for cosmetic surgery, you guys do a pretty extensive background on why they're making the change. Like, what's part of the conversation that takes place before it's locked in that you're going to do a facelift or a tummy tuck or whatever it might be?
Well, that's an excellent question, and there's many motivations why people might want to enhance, alter, change, or modify their appearance slightly. And you know, we live in, as you mentioned off the top, a very external oriented visual culture, and it's very youth oriented. And we boomers help create that culture of youth, and we find ourselves aging in the same culture of youth and vitality that we created. So it creates a stress or juxtaposition for certain patients. Now, typically, most good plastic surgeons are going to look for the right indications, the right motivations. You know, typically, most reasonably well-adjusted people typically are going to select minor issues or concerns that bother them, and it might be as little as hair color. Skin tone, complexion, manicures, pedicures. There's guys, you know, we select Irish Spring. That's our skincare. And so typically it's it's women who are judged harshly by the age and appearance of their skin. And so typically you want to make sure that a patient is doing it for the right reasons. Well, what are the right reasons? You could say that in the right world, we would go proudly forth with the age and wrinkles and drooping and sagging that we've accumulated. And some people do that and say, this is me and I'm proud of it. And others will select to intervene, typically with little things, a little Botox or filler, or little laser, tweak their skin so their skin looks youthful and vibrant and healthy. And so most women and guys, if we dig deep enough, will want healthy skin. A certain subset of patients will want to alter that skin and lift it and tighten it. And it's not for everybody. But it's become something that can be done under local anesthesia, and it's reasonably quick recovery. You want to make sure that people are doing it for the right reasons, which is they feel that they would like to project a different look of youth and vitality. They're not doing it to save a marriage or get off antidepressants or get a raise at work. These are unrealistic expectations. The expectation should be that you've elected to alter your appearance slightly or moderately through surgery. And you can accept the risks and benefits of that. And there's a number of people that will do that. And increasingly in our culture, we live in an ageistic society, unfortunately. As you get old, a lot of people will tell you, you start to feel a little invisible, like people don't trust you, don't listen to you. Whereas our generation, you and me, we respected our elders. In our culture, typically the millennials abandoned us as old and wizened and irrelevant. And it's not fair, but it's just how age is perceived. So I think for the right person, modest changes that have realistic expectations, I like to look maybe 7-8 years younger, but still me, is typically what I see from patients that are well-adjusted.
Dr. Stephen Mulholland with us. When it comes to your day-to-day grind in the cosmetic surgery business, is there a demographic gap in the work you do? Because I know we've heard a lot about younger women and younger men who are trying to get that Instagram look. So there's certainly a business model there, and certainly breast augmentations and that sort of stuff. But is there an age gap where you're like, you see people till a certain age and then you don't see them till they're older again? Or is it all shapes and sizes and all ages that are doing things?
It's a great question. Well, first of all, I'm fortunate. My work is never a grind. I love what I do, and I still can't believe I get paid for it. It's amazing. I'm a cutaneous philanthropist, and I get to work with people's skin and appearance. And typically, like most medical professions, no one's sick, and everybody typically ends up pretty happy. So it used to be there were really two big bulges. There was, you know, those in their 70s and 80s, and they were just tweaking little things they'd done in their 60s, and you didn't really see people in their 30s and 40s, and most women and some men would wait till their 60s to have surgery. That all changed with non-invasive treatments, our energy-based devices, lasers and electro-radio frequency devices and Botox and fillers. So now the average age of first entrance in two little tweaks, Botox, for instance, is typically early to mid-30s, where millennials will say, I really don't want to get wrinkles as my mother did, or I want to enhance lips, as you suggested, for some Instagram reason. And millennials aren't a tremendous amount of pressure. They're judged instantly on these dating apps. It's a right or left swipe, or job interviews. It's extremely competitive. And so there's a number of reasons why young women and even guys now in urban Toronto will start doing little tweaks in their 30s and 40s. And typically after kids and in your late 40s, you might do eye surgery like a blepharoplasty or brow surgery. And then in your 50s, you might tweak the jowl. And then in your 60s, you might treat your neck. So someone like Sharon Osbourne, which is the unrealistic extreme of this model, typically tweaks something about every 8 years. And she always looks perpetually 50, and she's 68 years old. And so, yeah, we tend to see people in each decade doing little tweaks, so you never really look terribly old, you don't look terribly done, and you kind of have this perpetual vitality about you if it's done well.
Dr. Stephen Mulholland, founder of Spa Medica and one of Canada's top cosmetic surgeons. Doc, we appreciate you sharing some information tonight.
Thank you so much.
There you go. On the text, John, if you want, I can start a GoFundMe for you. If you're feeling insecure, what would you like to change first? It's a good question. What would I like to change first? How do you top perfection? I don't know. I think I'm good. I don't have anything I want to change. I'm perfectly happy with how I am. But you know what? You start that GoFundMe. You just send me the cash. That's all I want. Just send me the cash. I'll be good with that.